The event-driven model doesn't come without any challenges. Recall that when we talked about the many-to-one multithreading model, we said that a single blocking I/O call that's coming from one of the user-level threads can block the entire process, although there may be other user-level threads that are ready to execute. A similar problem can occur here as well. If one of the handlers issues a blocking I/O call to read data from the network or from disk, the entire event-driven process can be blocked. One way to circumvent this problem is to use asynchronous I/O operations. Asynchronous calls have the property that when the system call is made, the kernel captures enough information about the caller and where and how the data should be returned once it becomes available. Async calls also provide the caller with an opportunity to proceed executing something and then come back at a later time to check if the results of the asynchronous operation are already available. For instance, the process or the thread can come back later to check if a file has already been read and the data is available in a buffer in memory. One thing that makes asynchronous calls possible is that the OS kernel is multi-threaded, so while the caller thread continues execution, another kernel thread does all the necessary work and all the waiting that's needed to perform the I/O operation to get the I/O data and then to also make sure that the results become available to the appropriate user-level context. Also, asynchronous operations can benefit by the actual I/O devices. For instance, the caller thread can simply pass some request data structure to the device itself, and then the device performs the operation, and the thread at a later time can come and check to see whether the device has completed the operation. We will return to asynchronous I/O operations in a later lecture. What you need to know for now is that when we're using asynchronous I/O operations, our process will not be blocked in the kernel when performing I/O. In the event-driven model, if the handler initiates an asynchronous I/O operation for network or for disk, the operating system can simply use a mechanism like select or poll or epoll that we mentioned before to catch such events. So in summary, asynchronous I/O operations fit very nicely with the event-driven model. The problem with asynchronous I/O calls is that they weren't ubiquitously available in the past, and even today, they may not be available for all types of devices. In a general case, maybe the processing that needs to be performed by our server isn't to read data from a file where there are asynchronous system calls, but instead maybe to call processing on some accelerator, some device that only the server has access to. To deal with this problem, Vivek Pai's paper proposed the use of helpers. When a handler needs to issue an I/O operation that can block, it passes it to the helper and returns to the event dispatcher. The helper will be the one that will handle the blocking I/O operation and interact with the dispatcher as necessary. The communication with the helper can be via a socket-based interface or via another type of messaging interface that's available in operating systems called pipes. And both of these present a file descriptor-like interface. So the same kind of select or poll mechanism that we mentioned can be used for the event dispatcher to keep track of various events that are occurring in the system. This interface can be used to track whether the helpers are providing any kind of events to the event dispatcher. In doing this, the synchronous I/O call is handled by the helper. The helper will be the one that will block, and the main event dispatcher and the main process will continue uninterrupted. So this way, although we don't have asynchronous I/O calls, through the use of helpers, we achieve the same kind of behavior as if we had asynchronous calls. At the time of the writing of the paper, another limitation was that not all kernels were multithreaded. So basically, not all kernels supported the one-to-one model that we talked about. In order to deal with this limitation, the decision in the paper was to make these helper entities processes. Therefore, they call this model AMPED, Asymmetric Multiprocess Event-Driven Model. It's an event-driven model. It has multiple processes, and these processes are asymmetric. The helper ones only deal with blocking I/O operation, and then the main one performs everything else. In principle, the same kind of idea could have applied in a multi-threaded scenario where the helpers are threads, not processes, so asymmetric multi-threaded event-driven model. And in fact, there is a follow-on on the Flash work that actually does this exact thing, the AMTED model. The key benefits of the asymmetric model that we described is that it resolves some of the limitations of the pure event-driven model in terms of what is required from the operating system, the dependence on asynchronous I/O calls and threading support. In addition, this model lets us achieve concurrency with a smaller memory footprint than either the multiprocess or the multithreading model. In the multiprocess or multithreading model, a worker has to perform everything for a full request, so its memory requirements will be much more significant than the memory requirements of a helper entity. In addition, with the AMPED model, we will have a helper entity only for the number of concurrent blocking I/O operations, whereas in the multithreaded or multiprocess models, we will have as many concurrent entities, as many processes or as many threads, as there are actual concurrent requests, regardless of whether they block or not. The downside is that although it works well with the server-type applications, it is not necessarily as generally applicable to arbitrary applications. In addition, there are also some complexities with the routing of events in multi-CPU systems.